On the 20th of October 2011, Muammar Gaddafi, the dictator that ruled over Libya for over 42 years, was finally captured and killed. He was executed by rebels in the streets of the town Sitre, where he was born. So he died where he was born on June the 7th, 1942. He was born in 42 and ruled for 42 years. This is general knowledge that you might have heard on the news, on the TV. But there's a lot to be uncovered or revealed as truth about Muammar Gaddafi, starting with his name. He wasn't called Muammar Gaddafi, and surely he wasn't called Gaddafi with one D. His name was Muammar Muhammad Abu Minyamar al-Gaddafi, formerly known as Colonel Gaddafi. He didn't name himself General or Admiral. He was a Libyan revolutionary, politician and political theorist, not terrorist, and was not born in Sirte but Kasr Abu Hadi, Libya. His last words were pretty sad. "What did I did to you?" Words that might be fitting if YouTube would be a freer place for expression, not just a fun place to hang. In short, those rebels had external funding. They were rallied by Western countries. Also, the media painted him in a dark color to make the world happy to hear he was overthrown and killed, glad that another dictator has demised, while living in a country that dictated his demise. Ironic, I know. Also, discussing the details of all this operation is not a fun YouTube thing to do. The same media that painted him as a hero when Libya-US relationships were started to lubricate, aka oil, lots and lots of oil. But I digress. Let's see a few fun, weird things about Muammar Gaddafi, because looking at this guy, at this dictator, you can see there's a lot to talk about. Let's begin. For starters, he attended the Libyan Military Academy and also received training in Greece and the United Kingdom. He seized power after a coup d'etat on September 1st, 1969. The coup d'etat was a bloodless coup. Nobody died. He ruled for 42 years until he was 69. Somewhere in his mind, that number might have made him giggle. He took over from King Idris I, who at the time was seeking medical attention in Turkey. He wasn't succeeded by nobody. Libya is still divided between political factions. And before becoming colonel, he was captain. He promoted himself. He did a fine job. He married twice and had 7 sons and a daughter. Also, being a political theorist, he developed what he called the third universal theory, which is explained in his infamous Green Book, published in 1975. Gaddafi had a bulletproof tent. While he was at home in Tripoli, he lived in a well-fortified compound with a complex system of escape tunnels. But when he traveled abroad, he took his Bedouin approach and look and persona with him, including a bit of desert and a tent with camels at the door. He was camping out in the world's capitals. The tent was so heavy it needed to be flown in a separate plane wherever the dictator traveled. Flying wasn't easy for him. He had a fear of flying and elevators. He loved traveling with that tent because he was worried about lodging in a hotel where he'd have to ride an elevator. According to leaked diplomatic cables, the Libyan didn't like heights much either and would only climb to a height of 35 steps. He therefore wasn't much of a fan of flying, refusing to travel by air for more than 8 hours at a time. When he would travel to New York City, for example, for a UN event, he stopped in Portugal, slept for a night, and continued to New York. Bunga Bunga, aka intimacy with a lot of people, wasn't invented by Gaddafi. Still, in 2010, one of Gaddafi's most eccentric pastimes was exposed by Italian prosecutors investigating Italian Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi. A 17-year-old paid for intimate actions named Karima El Mahog, better known as Ruby Heartstealer, revealed that she had been invited to parties called Bunga Bunga, and Silvio told me that he'd copied that formula from Muammar Gaddafi. According to him, it's a ritual of Gaddafi's African harem. In no other point in history, no European royal family, no great scholars of the ancient Greek world or Roman world were doing that. No, it all started with Muammar Gaddafi. He also had voluptuous Ukrainian nurses, because you must have when you're a dictator. For a decade, Galina Kolotsnika, a Ukrainian nurse often described in the press as voluptuous, was regularly seen at the doctor's side. She was described as one of Gaddafi's closest aides and was rumored to have a romantic relationship with him. Several other Ukrainian women served as nurses and called him Papa or Daddy. Also, the world thought he had a personal guard of virgins called Amazons. 40. not one, 40. They weren't around when Gaddafi needed them the most. They were busy being killed. But the eccentric dictator was historically protected by 40 well-trained bodyguards, all of them women. The Amazons were all virgins. They took a vow of chastity and they trained in an all-female military academy. After that, they were handpicked by Gaddafi. They wore elaborate uniforms, as well as makeup and high-heeled combat boots. Unfortunately, this is not true either. Despite the fact that in this army, women had a much different empowered role than in a traditional Islamic society, the guards had to only fight if needed, as in the day of the revolution, to save their lives. They had ceremonial role, and they had to support the male army, which came with a asterisk, support. Unfortunately for some women, men are pigs. A 19-year-old soldier recalls a little room at the end of a corridor. Random soldier would come, grab her by the hand, and everybody knew what's going to happen. So that vow of chastity would have been great, but not true, unfortunately. If you were to go willingly, you would have been called a whore. If you didn't go willingly, abused. A female soldier captured after the revolution, being on trial, said, "What could I have done? I was put in the army. I didn't have a choice in being the army. I didn't have a choice in being here. The only thing that I could have chosen along my life was when I were to die. I postponed my point of death until today in front of you. I had to protect myself." That's the sad and YouTube part of this video. He had a crush on Condoleezza Rice. In 2007, he called her his darling black African woman. In 2008, when she visited Tripoli, the dictator gave her $2,000 worth of gifts, including a ring and a lute. But it wasn't until rebels stormed his Tripoli compound that the depths of the dictator's infatuation were exposed. There, among Gaddafi's belongings, was a carefully composed photo album made up of dozens of images of no one but Condoleezza Rice. There is a quote of Gaddafi that explains his wardrobe. "Freedom of expression is the right of every natural person, even if a person chooses to behave irrationally, to express his or her insanity." In those photos of world leaders standing shoulder to shoulder on sidelines of a random international event, forum, union, Gaddafi was always the easiest to pick up out of the crowd. He was a sniper's dream target. He had a wardrobe with an eclectic mix of ornate military uniforms, Miami Vice-style leisure suits, Bedouin robes, and he did that for a reason. He pushed for a Pan-African Federation of Nations, similar to the EU or United States, and he often decorated his outfits with images of the African continent. He'd sport safari shirts with an African pattern, or wear garish pins or necklaces of the continent. He loved his country, and just before his death, he raised 150 tons of gold and similar amount in silver to start a Pan-African currency. To put it in perspective, that's 10 times lower than the US, but only half of Great Britain. It still would have been in the top 15 countries in the world. Unfortunately, today Libya is not living the dream, it's split between rival governments, rival gangs, rival interests. In 2016, a resident of Libya said, "We are in a period that's much worse than the last, and Libya is threatened with extinction." Another said that after the fall of the previous regime, "We hoped that with the will of God, things would be better because we expect a lot from our country." Another resident said, "We hope that those who love their country will unite to create national reconciliation. It's the only way for the country to be built, God willingly." So why was Muammar Gaddafi removed from power? In the wake of the Arab Spring revolutions in Tunisia and Egypt, late 2010 and early 2011, the conventional narrative, at least in the Western media, soon became one of unstoppable tidal wave of emancipation. This was expected to leave no stone unturned, at least in the decaying Arab republics. In this context, the Benghazi uprising in eastern Libya in February 2011 was widely portrayed as the start of yet another revolution, both nationwide and organic, natural. The people of the country just felt the same and wanted to take down Gaddafi. As the weeks dragged on, however, with Gaddafi still in power and the bulk of the Libyan armed forces apparently remaining loyal, this narrative had to be abandoned and replaced by a new one depicting a desperate regime clinging to power by wielding extreme violence against its people and deploying vicious foreign mercenary. By March 2011, it was generally assumed that Gaddafi's fighters, whoever they were, would massacre thousands of civilians if they managed to re-enter Benghazi. And if the Western powers and their regional allies did not step up to the plate with some sort of humanitarian intervention on behalf of the Libyan revolution. The revolution did happen, and at the time several analysts did try to question the details underpinning these two interlinked narratives. Still, it took more than 5 years before any real willingness emerged in Western government circles to investigate more thoroughly the events of 2011. Published in 2016, for example, a British parliamentary report recognized that the eventual NATO-led intervention had gone badly wrong and conceded that the intelligence it was based on was not necessarily credible in the first place. Entitled Libya: Examination of Intervention and Collapse and the UK's Future Policy Options, it drew the conclusion that former British Prime Minister David Cameron was primarily to blame for the ensuing chaos in the wake of Gaddafi's removal due to his decision-making in the UK National Security Council and his failure to develop a coherent Libya strategy. But beyond this superficial and heavily publicized reading that really doesn't go into much detail of what happened, a substantial body of evidence has now emerged that allows for a much deeper understanding of the Libyan uprising and the NATO intervention. In particular, the contents of hundreds of recently declassified files, court subpoenaed materials, and leaked official correspondence strongly suggest that the two mainstream narratives of 2011 and even the British Parliament's belated findings have largely obscured the real reasons behind Gaddafi's removal and the methods used to make it happen. In short, the 2011 Arab Spring phenomenon was manipulated by external factors to provide diplomatic cover for the calculated dismantling of a Libyan regime that had remained largely resistant to the opening up of its economy to Western investment and inconveniently was still able to count on a significant domestic support base. The Libyan regime had not only failed to establish itself as a reliable partner in the long-running US war on terror, but had actually emerged as one of the strongest voices opposing the expansion of NATO and the US military power onto the African continent. Muammar Gaddafi saw what happened to Osama bin Laden. He didn't want to have the same fate, so he opened the doors slowly but surely to the British and the US, started some businesses to export oil, but not fast enough, and he still opposed NATO and US expansion in Africa because it clashed with his plan of a rich, free Africa with its own currency that would rival the euro and the US dollar. Muammar Gaddafi wasn't only betrayed by his partners, but we as citizens of the civilized world are betrayed by our countries that should really do better. There are better ways of moving a vehicle from right to left than oil. That's all for today. I'd like to thank the two new subscribers on the channel. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you enjoy it and it made your day a little better. Until next time, don't forget to share, like, subscribe, hit the notification button. I'm Alex and beware of falling apples.